Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Kyrie,
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whom truly to know is everlasting life, grant us so perfectly to know your Son, Jesus Christ, to be the way, the truth, and the life, that we may steadfastly follow his steps in the way that leads to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Filled with the Holy Spirit, Stephen gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. "Look," he said, "I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." But they covered their ears, and with a loud shout, all rushed together against him. Then they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. And the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning Stephen, he prayed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Then he knelt down and cried out in a loud voice, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." When he had said this, he died. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. A reading from 1 Peter. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight, and like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, "See, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame." To you then, who believe, he is precious. But for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do not know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, Show me the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The word that I say to you, do I not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his work. Believe in me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in the fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. The Gospel of the Lord.
In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. So there are a lot of time jumps in today's readings. While you and I are still in this Easter season, today's gospel reading takes us back to what we call the Last Supper, before Jesus is put to death. And we've got another jump in that first reading we heard today. Stephen, the first Christian martyr, is stoned to death by the religious leaders, which happens long after the resurrection of Jesus. As far as the flow of the narrative, we are all over the map today. But there is a thread running through readings today that I want to be sure we notice. The first reading from Acts recounts the stoning of Stephen, brutal and horrible and senseless. The religious leader's reaction to the gospel is unthinkable in our country today, but it still goes on elsewhere in our world. Plenty of places, in fact. Christianity is still a dangerous road to travel, and we are offered no guarantees of protection. As Jesus says in today's gospel, "Trust in God, trust also in me." Stephen did exactly that, and his dying words are recorded as, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. In today's psalm, we heard, "Into your hands I commend my spirit, for you have redeemed me, O Lord, O God of truth." And you probably remember, in Luke's gospel, Jesus says from the cross, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." Into your hands I commend my spirit. For Stephen, for the psalmist, and for Jesus. The connection I want us to see here is the continued unfailing trust in God to receive our spirit. When it all comes down to it, that is the most important part of our faith journey, trusting that God will indeed receive our spirit when it matters most. So now, back to this gospel text. Keep in mind what happened right before this reading we just heard. Jesus has washed his disciples' feet, predicted his own death, and told Peter that he will deny him three times. Then Jesus says, "Do not let your heart be troubled." What? After all of that crazy information, do not let your heart be troubled? And the language is important here because "your" is plural and "heart" is singular. He's talking to everyone in the room, but he's talking as if they have just one heart, one collective heart, a heart which is not to be troubled by what he is saying. Then he gives them the reason not to be troubled: trust in God and trust in me. It gets translated into "believe in God" for us, but the original word pistuo is closer to confidence and trust than it is to belief. And this distinction is important because there really is a difference between belief and trust. For example, I believe in democracy, but I trust in gravity. My belief in democracy might influence my decisions and choices and attitudes, sure. But my trust in gravity determines how I live my life. From picking up a glass to going outside without a rope, gravity is something you trust, and it would not usually occur to you to do otherwise. Trusting in God and trusting in Jesus are not something you choose to believe intellectually. They are not some preference for one thing over another. In a sense, we cannot help but trust in Jesus. It is just the way we are, how we see the world, whether we know it or not. And then Jesus follows up the trust statement with something that seems puzzling to us, I think. And it seems puzzling because it has been interpreted certain ways for so long that we automatically think we know what it means. He says, "In my Father's house there are many dwelling places." Since we have a fairly fixed idea of what a house is, we picture a massive mansion somewhere, maybe with marble floors and Viking appliances. And for many people, the best part of that image is that it is plural, places, rooms, meaning we don't ever have to run into the people we don't like. But there is an interesting connection between the word interpreted as dwelling places and a temporary stopping point. Some scholars say that this word, monai, is something like a place set up to receive visitors traveling through. Not a private place to kick back and live out your eternal retirement, but a public place to be welcomed after a long journey with good food and a place to rest. When we go to where Jesus is waiting, we don't put out our hand to receive our personal room keys. Instead, Jesus stretches out his arms to receive us, a welcome to the party, if you will. And then here's the part of this little story that I really like. Jesus ends his flowery speech with, "And you know the way to the place that I am going." Cut to disciples shoving their hands in their pockets, kicking the dirt, not wanting to be the one to ask the obvious question that they're all thinking. But leave it to Thomas to speak up. Leave it to Thomas to be the one who wants reliable information and a roadmap. Leave it to Thomas to look up and say, "Know the way? We don't even know where you're going. How can we possibly know the way?" And then I imagine Jesus looking at them and saying, "Ahem, people, I am the way. Remember me, the way and the truth and the life? You don't have to know where you're going because you know the way." Now, of course, this is contrary to everything we learn about directions. You get directions as a means to get where you're going. Knowing the way is never the point, is it? Tell me the destination, and then the way is just details, because there are many paths. I might take the 90, I might take Euclid Avenue. Just tell me the destination. Lots of people view Christianity in exactly this way. I want to go to heaven, so tell me the behavior modification plan that will get me to the desired destination, and I'll take it from here, Jesus. But Jesus stands this on its head and says, "You do not need to know the destination. You just need to know the way. Trust in God, trust in me. If you know the way, you will end up where you're supposed to go, even though you don't know the destination. And you, the collective you, you know the way. All of us together are on a journey with Jesus, destination unknown, but we know the way." It is hard to believe that we know the way right now, isn't it? We look at where we are and where we want to be, and it doesn't seem like we know how to get there. Show us the way to being able to have civil conversations with our family and friends again. Show us the way to feeling safe in a grocery store or a shopping mall, let alone a school. Show us the way not to wake up panicked in the middle of the night wondering if we're going to have a job tomorrow. Show us the way to get people to come back to church again. Show us the way, Lord. Now, I can't help but think that this gospel text would be heard so much differently back in the 50s and 60s, back when there was a discernible middle in most things. Back when NASA had a room full of people in short-sleeved button-down shirts and matching glasses using slide rules to land a man on the moon. back when vaccines were widespread and trusted and effective, back when we knew the way. And now, here we are in 2023, where almost half our citizens don't trust science or data or medical professionals about anything. In a world where politicians try their darndest to clear out the middle and get everyone to yell from the corners of the room. In a virtual world of AI and deep fakes, and a physical world of multiple mass shootings every single day. This is where we are together right now. This is the world in which we live together. So now you tell me, how do we get out of this? We don't even know where we are going. How can we possibly know the way? And Jesus says to us, just as he says to Thomas, I am the way. We don't know where we are going, but Jesus is the way. If you know the way, you will end up where you're supposed to be, even if you don't know the destination. And you, people of Trinity, you know the way. You are on a journey with Jesus, destination unknown, but you know the way. We know the way to the Father because Jesus is the way. We trust in God because we trust in Jesus. With Stephen and the psalmist and Jesus, we pray that God will receive our spirit. Do not let our heart be troubled because we know the way. It's true, we don't truly know where we are going, but we are going there together. We are going there together. We disagree and we walk in darkness, but we are walking together. And as we walk together, Jesus walks beside us and shows us the way himself. And that is why we are going to be okay, because we know the way. And when we have arrived at that unknown destination, God will receive our spirit and say to us, all of us, welcome home, weary travelers. Do not let your heart be troubled because you have known the way all along. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray that the power of Christ's resurrection may be seen throughout the world. Lord God, our loving Creator, we thank and praise you for the glorious resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Your Passover lamb has taken away the sin of the world. Guide us and all people into the forgiveness and reconciliation Christ promises. By the power of your love, Christ, hear our prayer. Our Savior said, "Peace be with you. Bring your peace to the world and to our country. Guide the leaders of your church and of this nation, that together we may see God's power manifest among us." By the power of your love, Christ hear our prayer. Our Savior met the women at the tomb and asked them to tell the disciples about his resurrection. Guide Christians everywhere to witness to the resurrection in their lives and share the good news of Christ throughout the world. By the power of your love,
Christ hear our prayer.
Our Savior proclaimed his resurrection to the two disciples from the scriptures and made himself known to them in the breaking of the bread. Reveal him to us and all people through the teaching of your word and the celebration of your holy meal. By the power of your love,
Christ hear our prayer.
Our Savior strengthened the faith of Thomas by telling him to touch his hand and side, and appeared to Mary Magdalene when she was weeping. Reassure those who are troubled by doubts, and comfort those who are in pain, lonely, or grieving. As we pray for our own needs and also those of others, especially Brad, Eric, Paul, Lori, Charlotte, Robin, David, Deborah, Jim, Nancy, Stuart, Ruth Ann, Tanya, Tim, Chris, Jill, and the Mullaly family and the Perez family. We pray for United States military personnel and for their families. We pray for our companions in the Diocese of Belize and the Diocese of Tanga, Tanzania. In the Diocesan Cycle of Prayer, we pray for St. Matthew's Church, Ashland, Harcourt Parish, Gambier, Grace Church, Mansfield. In the Anglican Cycle of Prayer, we pray for the churches in the Diocese of Sulacatel, Brazil. We pray for our congregational ministries and volunteers, especially for the diocesan and national ministry mission team as they support the larger mission of the Episcopal Church through diocesan and national programs and causes. We offer blessings upon those celebrating birthdays this week: Steve Emery, Kim Kovach, Phil Kovach, Andy Lane, and Addison Morales York. By the power of your love,
hear our prayer.
Our Savior conquered death by his death and won the victory by his resurrection. Be with those who are dying and lead them to life with you forever. And we have prayers for our loved ones who have recently died and for their families, especially Catherine McGee, Patrick Milani, and Edward Remier. By the power of your love,
Christ hear our prayer. O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls. And to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Good evening and welcome. Please be seated. Peace be with you. A word of thanks to my for my mind, which has just dropped right out of my head, just dropped right out. George and Rosalind and Dan, thank you all for being here. Welcome this evening. We're so glad that you are here this evening. If you're joining us online, we welcome you. If you're joining us here in person, we're very glad you're here as well. And I just want to know, has anybody here completed the trifecta, which is coronation, Kentucky Derby, and Solemn Eucharist? Anybody get all three? Well done, everybody. Well done. We do not have juleps for you afterwards, though, sadly. So glad you can be here. And in just a moment, we will also, this is a very special evening for us because we're going to dedicate a new thurible that Dan Sanger has donated in memory of his mother, Marie. And we'll do that in just a moment. I want to talk about a few things that are coming up in the coming few weeks. First of all, this coming Wednesday is the last choral evensong of the year. We will welcome the Illuminari Choir of St. John's in Youngstown. So we'd love to have you join us for that in person or online. And a week from Thursday, not this Thursday, but the following Thursday, I believe it's the 18th, is Ascension Day, one of the principal feasts in the Christian year, and we will be gathering here for service of Holy Eucharist that evening. Before then, next Saturday, we will be gathering at the Trinity Urban Farm, and all are welcome to join us for that 10 a.m. for a Guns to Gardens event. As George mentioned, as we find ourselves saying again and again from the pulpit, and of course, just again yesterday, yet another mass shooting in Texas, this epidemic of gun violence. There are so many ways that we want to engage with it, and one way, and we're so grateful to Rosalind Hughes for bringing this to our community and our diocese, is through these Guns to Garden events, where we will take a gun that has been turned in previously, we won't be collecting that when we're there, and we're going to place it into the forge and turn something that is an instrument of death into something that can be an instrument for life, whether that is a garden tool or piece of jewelry or piece of artwork. So a way for us really to gather actively, prayerfully in vigil. So this is the 13th, 10 a.m. At the Trinity Urban Farm. We hope you can join us for that. Later in the month, on Tuesday, 6:30 here in the cathedral, our worship, art, and music mission team will be hosting an artist named Kamayo. Kamayo, she's a singer-songwriter from New Hampshire. She's doing a tour called My Queer Faith. And she's chosen churches, synagogues throughout the country to perform. It was really important for her to do it. It's an hour of storytelling and song. It was really important to her to do this in sanctuaries, in houses of faith, in order to tell her story and to invite others into it. So we hope you could join us for that, free of charge, though donations are welcome. And that will be Tuesday, the 23rd of May. Doors open at 6, and we conclude, the service begins at 6:30. Dan, Bishop, would you like to join us? You will find in your bulletin the service for the dedication of a vessel for incense. Please rise. Another angel came and stood at the altar with a golden censer. He was given much incense, and the smoke of the incense rose with the prayers of the saints. The four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb. each held golden vessels full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. Let us pray. Almighty God, whose only begotten Son received from the wise men a gift of incense and made for us the pure oblation foretold by the prophet, we dedicate to your worship this vessel, that our prayers may ascend in your sight as the incense, and the pure oblation of our Lord be proclaimed from farthest east to farthest west, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
As Christ loves us and gave himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God.
Oh,
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right.
God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise.
Glory to you forever and ever.
At your command, all things came to be, the vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home.
By your will, they were created and have their being.
From the primal elements, you brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against one another.
Have mercy, Lord,
for we are sinners in your sight. Again and again, you called us to return. Through prophets and sages, you revealed your righteous law, and in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace.
By his blood, he reconciled us.
By his wounds, we are healed. And therefore, we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope, to proclaim with them your glory in their unending hymn.
Thank you.
And so, Father, we who have been redeemed by him and made a new people by water and the Spirit, now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption and offering to you this sacrifice of thanksgiving, we celebrate his death and resurrection as we await the day of his coming. Lord God of our mothers and fathers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world around us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this Holy Communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name. Risen Lord, be known to us in the breaking of the bread.
Accept these prayers and praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great High Priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit your Church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven, give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
The gifts of God for the people of God. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven.
Sing unto the Lord.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. May our God, who brought again our Savior Jesus Christ from the dead, enliven you with the grace of the Holy Spirit, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.
Let us go forth into the world, rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia.